Your country needs you, and so does Nicole Sandler. Subscribe right now to The Nicole Sandler Show on YouTube.
Mike Revelle, again, if you're not familiar with Mike Revelle, he's I believe he's 88 years old now. He was a U.S. senator from Alaska. He served from 1968 to 1981. He ran for the presidency in 2008 and is again running for the Democratic nomination in 2020. Now, Mike Revelle was a fierce opponent of the Vietnam War. And in 1971, he basically took Daniel Ellsberg. Let me share this with you from Mike Revelle's website because it's really important. Let me see if I can find it. Oh, of course, I closed out that page. Damn it. Well, all right, so I won't read it. But Daniel Ellsberg had just gotten the Pentagon Papers and he was trying to get them published, but he needed somebody to read them into the congressional record. Enter Mike Revelle. He took Ellsberg up on his offer and he read the Pentagon Papers into the congressional record, thus giving him cover to for the New York Times and the Washington Post and other papers to publish them. Pretty revolutionary move on his behalf. After leaving the Senate in 1981, Gravel left Washington, D.C. He worked as an anti-war and pro-direct democracy activist, as well as the CEO of several cannabis companies, something I did not know about. All right, let's call. Let's try to call Mike Revelle. He was supposed to call us, but I haven't heard from him yet. So let's get him on the line. I know he's expecting our call. Hey, Senator Revelle?
Yes, speaking.
Hey, hi, it's Nicole Sandler calling from the Nicole Sandler Show. We're supposed to talk right now?
Yeah, I called a little bit ago.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I must have missed the call. Well, we're on the air now, if that's okay.
Okay, that's okay.
Terrific. Well, I just played the video, the Rock 2.0 video, that brought back some memories of 2008, but it's updated a little bit. So, first of all, thank you for running. Can I ask what was it that made you decide to do this again?
It was because David and Henry and Ben persuaded me that the top priority of the campaign would be creation of a legislature of the people, and then several other key issues. But since I've devoted the last 25 years of my life to teeing up this legislation, a constitutional amendment and a federal statute to empower people to make laws, that's what floats my boat. And when they said that that's what they were for on a priority basis, that's what persuaded me. Obviously, there's no intent to run to win, but it's an intent to go ahead and shift the discussion and the debates to the left. You know, we all talk about people are, you know, want to be at the center, but the center today has been shifted to the right. So when people talk about being at the center, they're really right of center.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want to shift that back to the center is the center with the liberals on one side and the conservatives on the other.
Okay, so now, Senator Gravel, you mentioned David and Ben, and I forget the name of the third one, but these are three teenagers who live in New York who, what, they just discovered you? They contacted you? I'm really curious about how this came about because it's a great story.
Well, they discovered me on the web.
Uh-huh.
A chat, I forget the name of the, but it was a chat group. And David called me and said, Senator, we would like you to run for president. And I said, do you have any idea how old I am? And he says, well, that doesn't matter.
Uh-huh.
And of course, it does matter. And so it was only by him outlining the research that they had done on me and on Tulsi Gabbard, who I really support, that they persuaded me, and the key of persuasion was their support for the creation of a legislature of the people.
Hmm. Okay, I like that. So they took over your Twitter account, and you decided to work with them to launch a campaign, which is really aimed at getting you on the debate stage. I mean, that's the big goal here, right? To get you on that debate stage with the other candidates.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the real goal is to get me in the debates, and it's going to be difficult. You know, there's a real cutoff on the, which I think is somewhat unfair, to cut it off. But we have to get 65,000 donors from 20 different states, mm-hmm. or have 1% in the polls. Well, I don't see 1% in the polls as realistic, but there is a chance. Excuse me. There is a chance that that they could raise the. I think right now they got over 12,000 donors.
Wow!
To the tune of about $44,000.
Okay, so that's a start. So people can go to MikeRavelle.org and donate. And of course, you have an Act Blue page where I love the amounts you have here: $1, $2, $4.20. $5, $10, or pick your own amount. The $4.20, obviously, a nod to the time you've spent working in the cannabis industry. Are you? I'm guessing these kids put this together. Did you know that $4.20 was one of the amounts they put in the Act Blue page?
No, not at all. This is news to me. I have not followed them that closely. They gave me veto power on whatever they're doing. And of course, I gave them the Twitter account, which I never used, and that's what's propagating the website. But I just have confidence in how they're doing it and what they're doing. I don't intend to meddle into their tactics. They came here. Two of them came here for the weekend.
Oh, nice!
And we did a shoot for. HBO News and another shoot for a person who wants to present something to Netflix. So it was a busy weekend, but it also gave me the opportunity to meet Henry and Ben firsthand and discuss with them the course of the campaign. David had a condition where he had to go to the hospital for a couple of days. But what we'll do is once they're out of school and they're full time in school right now, but once they're out of school, they'll be just full time and they'll come back out and we'll do some planning and see what our chances are of getting the 65,000 by the deadline.
I love it.
If they're successful, fine. If they're not successful, then we'll donate the money to charities, various organizations.
I love it. And in fact, on your website, it does say that at the end, any money left over will go to all leftover funds will be donated to get clean water for Flint, Michigan, which I think is a pretty good goal. It's a travesty that Flint is still dealing with that disgusting water there. So Mike Gravel, the one thing, when you say the name Senator Mike Gravel, the first thing that most people who are familiar with your history think of is the Pentagon Papers. And I'm wondering if you see any kind of correlation between the importance of the Pentagon Papers back in 1971 and perhaps the Mueller report today?
Yes, very much so. In fact, it continues to be ridiculous that the secrecy pattern of people in government is far too extreme. There's no reason why the Mueller report in its entirety should be transferred to a public domain or certainly given to Congress. But here again, you have a government official who's going to redact it. What's the purpose of redaction? This is information that was acquired via a special person to go ahead and investigate, and that was paid for by tax dollars. What is there that should be denied the American public? Here again, it's the culpability of bureaucrats who fancy themselves far superior to the needs of the American people, and that is for the people to know what's going on in their government so that they can react to that situation. So, yes, that's exactly what happened with the Pentagon Papers. Here in McNamara did a study as to how we got into Vietnam, and after the study was complete, he read it, and top secret, and hidden away. Now, if it was important for the Secretary of State to know how we got into Vietnam, it was 1,000 times more important for the American people to know how we got into Vietnam. And so this secrecy continues to plague our democracies, and until we can get the people in power to make laws to limit this secrecy by government, and of course that's why I'm so supportive of WikiLeaks for what they did in revealing information that rightly the people should know about.
Sure.
So the parallel, I think, is accurate and unfortunate.
Can I go back to when Daniel Ellsberg approached you about the Pentagon Papers? He was obviously going afoul of the law. He was doing something that was against the rules, trying to get them published. But I guess he realized before he get them published, he needed somebody to read them into the record. And from what I understand, he went around to Congress trying to find somebody, and Mike Gravel was the one who stepped up. How did that come about? Was that a hard decision to make, or did you say, absolutely, I want to do this?
Well, it was an instantaneous decision, and it was not hard to make. When I was 23 years old, I was an adjutant for the Communications Intelligence Service. I could classify and declassify. And so now we move ahead. I'm 42 years old. I'm a United States Senator, and the papers are sent over to the Senate by the President, Richard Nixon, and they're put under guard. And a member could go in and read the papers, but could not take any notes. So it went from the sublime to the ridiculous. And so when I got a call from Ellsberg, it was instantaneous. Yes, I'd be delighted to read the papers as part of my filibuster. And so we negotiated over the next couple of weeks to get the papers into my possession. And then I proceeded to release them, not on the floor, because I had been thwarted by the Republicans in that regard, but I was the chairman of the Buildings and Grounds. Now, mind you, I was a freshman. So I was chairman of Buildings and Grounds. And so using a precedent of the House Un-American Activities Committee, I called a hearing late at night, and a person came to testify and asked for a federal building in his district. And I said, well, I'd like to give you a federal building, but we don't have the money to do that. And the reason we don't have the money, because we're in Southeast Asia. And let me read to you how we got there. And I proceeded to read the Pentagon Papers.
Wow. And how long did that go for?
I went for about an hour and a half, 2 hours. Oh. And I'm dyslexic, so there's no way I could read all the papers in a reasonable period of time. And so I broke down emotionally. I hadn't slept for 3 or 4 days. And I was really afraid. I didn't realize what was going to happen to me, whether I'd be expulsed or prosecuted or what have you.
Right.
And so I broke down, and then I eventually got control. And my staff assistant said, well, Senator, why don't you drop it in the record? And then that sobered me up real quick. And so what it is, I'm the only person there on the committee. So I ask unanimous consent to place all these papers in the record of the subcommittee. And hearing no objections, I slammed the gavel and so ordered.
Wow.
And that's how the papers got into the Senate records of the United States Senate.
Wow.
And then, of course, after that, I wanted to publish them, because you see what happened with the Supreme Court decision of the same day that said that the newspapers, the government could not stop the papers from printing with prior restraint. But the Supreme Court did say that if the newspapers did print, then, of course, they'd be subject to prosecution. Now, the newspapers, after that reporting, did not print anymore. They had already printed some stuff, and they were at risk for that. And so they chose not to poke the government in the eye any further. Now, that left a dilemma, because what they had published thus far was not nearly enough of the Pentagon Papers. So I was able to go to Beacon Press, the only publication arm of the Unitarian Church, and the only one in the entire United States that was prepared to publish all of the papers. And so they did, And of course, Beacon Press, myself, and Daniel Ellsberg were all prosecuted by the Nixon administration under the Secrecy Act. Now, in my case, it went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court ruled unanimously that under the speech and debate clause of the Constitution, I could release what I did. But however, when I went to the private sector to publish the papers, that I was at risk also. And so that issue went all the way to the Supreme Court, and we lost. We won that any member of Congress could release whatever he or she felt the American public should know, and they could not be touched in any regard.
Wow.
But with respect to publishing beyond the Congress, that's a whole other matter. Mm-hmm. And Nixon could have put indicted me and the Beacon Press and what have you. But he was on his way to a big victory in re-election. And also, he was well aware of the beginnings of the criminality of Watergate, which he was deeply involved in.
We're speaking with Senator Mike Revelle. I'm honored that you're on the show today. Thank you so much for all you've done and for being here today and running to help, I think, pull the rest of the Democratic field to the left, something that I think Bernie Sanders effectively did 4 years ago. I'm wondering, Senator Gravel, if you would weigh in on some of the other candidates. You even said to us that you're not running with the intention of becoming president, but to get, you know, to open the debate, to get some of these issues out there. Among the field of those candidates who've already declared or are thinking of declaring, are there any that you support? Are there any that you think are better than others?
First and foremost, I support Tulsi Gabbard in her quest for president, or I hope she's selected for vice president if she doesn't make the presidency. I obviously would support Bernie Sanders. I contributed to him in the last go around, mm-hmm. and Senator Warren, mm-hmm. of Massachusetts. I think that she has some very specific good solutions to problems. Now, the other thing that will surprise you is I hope that that Michael Bloomberg will re-enter the race next year. Now, the reason why I feel he should be in a race is that we need to see, because the people that I'm for, Tulsi is more middle of the road, Tulsi Gabbard.
She is.
But Bernie certainly is not, and Warren certainly is not, but I still support them. And I think it's very critical to move the entire party to the left, because it's been moved to the right. So a person who's middle of the road right now is really on the right of the center because of what we've done in the last decade by the conservatives and Republicans. So, but Bloomberg, what I think is important, because he may turn out to be the only one that could beat Trump. And I think that's a paramount goal for all of us, is to deny Trump, who's essentially a narcissistic fool, deny him a second term. And so if the only person who could do that, and we could determine that through the polls, and that's the reason why I'd like to see Bloomberg get into the race, because if it turns out that he's the only one that could beat Trump, my God, we should support Michael Bloomberg. Now, keep in mind that in the last election that Bernie Sanders could have beaten Trump.
Yep.
But it's because of Obama and Hillary and Wasserman Schultz in the House, mm-hmm. who was the head of the Democratic Party. But the titular head of the party was Barack Obama.
Right.
And he set the stage by sabotaging with Hillary and Wasserman Schultz, sabotaging Bernie's campaign, when in point of fact, Bernie could have won. So we owe it all to Obama and Hillary for what we've got today.
I couldn't agree with you more, Senator. Can we talk for a moment about the precarious situation we're in now? I worry about the future of our republic with Donald Trump at the helm. I watched the attorney general that he installed, who auditioned for the job by basically writing a memo unrequested memo saying that, you know, a president can't be guilty of obstruction of justice, basically saying he'd acquit him if he made him attorney general. And he did. And this guy testified before the House yesterday and the Senate today and said some really, I think, undemocratic things, including accusing the intelligence community of spying, his words, on Trump's campaign. And worse, saying, I think what's worse is also saying that he will not release even to Congress an unredacted version of the Mueller report. I'm curious to know if you, what damage you think Donald Trump has done to this country and if we can come back from it.
Well, I think irreparable damage. And I don't think we can entirely come back from it, because what Trump has done is to diminish the leadership position of the United States in the world. Now, that position was being eroded with the rise of China. But what Trump has done is he's accelerated the rise of China and really destroyed any leadership that. We're the laughing stock of the world at this point in time with Trump at the helm. And we've showed with our leadership, Trump is cruel and mean to minority people. And so when the rest of the world looks at that, they're just saying, well, boy, this is what America has come to. And so can this be repaired? It would take a person with great gravitas, the persons that I would support, including Michael Bloomberg, would have that. But I don't see anybody on the horizon other than Bernie that has a chance of beating Trump. And Trump, of course, has become a lot more expert at campaigning and a lot more expert in using the power of government to get his ridiculous, cruel, dishonest message across, racist message across to the public. So I'm not convinced that the Democrats can beat Trump as a result of the stupidity of this program that immediately upon his election we're talking impeachment. Well, did they not realize that the efforts to impeach Clinton really pushed him up in the polls?
Yeah.
There's a dichotomy between personal conduct and leadership. And obviously, Trump's personal conduct is despicable. But his leadership is not from the point of view of his base. And so will that base shrink? I hope so. I think he's being supported by a bunch of religious nutcases. And his base is, 20% of the American public are dumb as fence posts, and that's his base.
Right.
And so will his base stay with him? Yes. Is it going to be enough to defeat? That's going to depend on the middle of the road people, the independents, whether they're going to realize that the Democrats, as flawed as they are a better alternative than Donald Trump.
Right. Well, Senator Gravel, you've staked out a very progressive platform. I'm with you on it. I'm also a Bernie Sanders supporter, Elizabeth Warren. I think this country has moved in a progressive direction. And someone in the chat room had an interesting point a few minutes ago. He said, pointing to what happened in Israel, where Netanyahu, again, unbelievably won a fifth term. This is what happens when you put up a centrist against a right winger. I think here in America, and especially the young people, are thirsting or hungering for progressive values. All the things that Bernie Sanders advocated 4 years ago that we were told was, pie in the sky: Medicare for all, tuition-free college and university, $15 an hour minimum wage, all the things that you're talking about as well. This is the direction the country is going in. But you mentioned Obama a few minutes ago. And did you hear his comments over the weekend of the circular firing squad, that we can't be too progressive?
Did Obama say that?
Oh, you didn't hear it. Hold on. I'm gonna.
No.
I'm gonna find the clip for you, and I'm gonna play it for you, because it's gonna here. All right. This was
it,
for
it, it.
Here, it's a 25-second clip. This is Barack Obama speaking this weekend.
One of the things I do worry about sometimes is a certain kind of rigidity where we say, I'm sorry, this is how it's going to be. And then we start sometimes creating what's called a circular firing squad. You start shooting at your allies because one of them is straying from purity on the issues.
Yeah, so that's what he said.
Boy, that's so typical of Obama. Mm-hmm. Here, the only thing he's ever going to be known for in history as a legacy is getting a black person elected president.
Right.
The rest of his presidency was just an abomination. And so this does not surprise me. But here again, what he's saying is don't do what the Republicans have done very successfully, and that is moving the American public to the right. The way you move people right or left is you put forth your proposals and you don't water them down like the Obama health care. When the Obama health care came out of the committee in the House way back when, it didn't even have an option of people making a decision for health care for all.
Right.
It just assumed that you couldn't get that done. Well, that's a false assumption, because what you got is something that's a subsidy to the insurance industry and the pharmaceutical industry. That's what Obamacare is all about.
Yep.
And so if you want if you want health care for all, just go do it.
Yeah.
And if you lose, you will move the people over to that persuasion and you'll win the next time.
Right. And Bernie Sanders today introduced his new Medicare for All legislation. So and 14 others, including most of the other Democratic candidates, all co-sponsored it right away.
Well, it just goes to show you, well, what Obama is doing with his statements right now is the same damage he did the last time by setting it up so Trump could win. Obama ought to go get his 60 some odd million dollar book deal and just retire from making these comments, which are injurious to the public interest as I see it.
Yeah, I agree.
But now in truth, let me just point out something that most people don't touch on. Other than the issue of nuclear, and this started under Obama, the government is spending $1.7 trillion on refurbishing our nuclear arsenal.
Yeah.
Now, like I said, this started under Obama, is continuing now. Well, what does that mean? That means that we are going to have more nuclear weapons, and the delivery systems will all be refurnished. They'll be the cruise missiles, the silos, the submarines, all of that. We have the ability under present restraint, which is Trump is going to remove, and that is to point our nuclear weapons at take 700 of our nuclear weapons and point them at our potential adversaries.
Yeah.
Now, what you have to understand is that nobody can use these weapons. And I really mean that.
Right. No, think. Of course.
If nobody can use these weapons, because if you do, it would trigger a nuclear winter and we're all going to die. So what is the point of having these weapons if you can't use them? And so you get the insanity of our existing military and political leaders that are toying with the possibility of a first strike. The first strike, the second strike. Here, if somebody's unloaded on us, you know, saying, well, we have our nukes, we can unload on them. Well, no, we don't need to unload on them. We're all going to die. Anybody who does a strike is going to trigger a nuclear winter.
Of course.
And so this is the insanity of our leadership, and the people can't do anything about it because the leadership can't even do anything about it. There's no way you can overcome the military-industrial complex and Wall Street under our present scenario. That's the reason why I want to empower the people to be able to make laws, because right now lawmaking is a monopoly by government.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, if you empower the people to make laws, I got to tell you, you're going to see a much different agenda enacted into law, because the people are not good. Here, if you ask the people, do you want any more nuclear devices? Obviously, that would fail.
Absolutely. Period. Senator Mike Gravel, we are just flat out of time. This has been a pleasure and an honor. I hope everybody goes to Mike Gravel, GRAVEL.org, make a donation so he gets to 65,000 from 20 states and gets on that debate stage, because we need your voice out there. Mike Gravel, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time, and it has been an honor talking with you.
Thank you for having me on your program.
All right.
Thank you.
You take care.
All the best.
Same to you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Wow. Well, that was very cool. All right. We are late. So thank you. We'll see you tomorrow back with Howie Klein for a Thursday. See you later, everyone.